1982. Prior to coming to SOAS, he completed his MA in African American Studies at Michigan State University, and his BA in International Affairs at Fordham University. Recently, he co-founded the Windhoek-based nonprofit Namibia Media Initiative, which produces educational documentary films for Namibian television. Several of his films have previously been broadcast in Namibia, South Africa, and Angola. So thank you so much for coming. We're very excited.
Well, thank you to everybody showing up for this. I mean, I'm talking about something that's a little bit strange to some people, partially because a lot of people don't even know where Namibia is, let alone what a rock hyrax is, or maybe even what a jackal is. But you're going to learn about some of those things today, God willing. And so this sort of is a work in progress that will eventually turn into my doctoral dissertation. It contains little bits of my MA project, as well as some new material that I've gathered over the past 2 years. And so the phrase, caught between a rock and a hyrax, sort of deals with this scenario of which sort of problem animal would you like to face as a farmer, the jackal or the dassie? And you're sort of stuck between both of these. So let's move forward. We'll be treating this as a little bit of a play. So, this will be act one, we're about to begin. But first, who's in this play? We've got Karakul's sheep. Karakul's sheep are a very unusual kind of sheep in the sense that they're not native to Africa at all. But in southern Namibia, they're basically what you've got. Karakul's sheep come from Central Asia, Iran, and Uzbekistan, Afghanistan. They're desert sheep, generally live in the mountains, and you breed them not for wool, not for meat, although you could eat them, they taste just fine. You breed them for pelts. So the goal of Karakul sheep, oh, here's just more of them in the pastures, is to breed them for the pelts. You slaughter lambs at 24 hours. Within the first 24 hours, you deflesh them and you spread out the pelt across a drying frame. Over a couple weeks, it will dry out and then you will export it to Copenhagen and it will become part of the fur trade. It's basically in the old days when people would go through Canada doing fur trapping or Finland fur trapping. This is farmed fur. You'll make luxury coats, luxury handbags, whatever from these. It's an incredibly soft skin, and if you do it right, it's also a very durable fur. But of course, from, I suppose, an animal rights perspective, it's a little bit shocking. But if you let that lamb get 3 days old, the skin tightens, it's no longer soft, you don't particularly want to wear that anymore. On a biological level, it also means by killing the lambs within the first day of life, the mother lamb, the ewe, is more likely to reproduce quicker, so you'll get another lamb in quicker. So the point is this becomes industrial fur farming. These were imported into Namibia from 1907, and today, although it's not as big an industry because fur is less in fashion, it still is a big deal. So here's an example of drying out in the sun or drying out on a drying frame. Our next character is the blackback jackal. Okay, this is the main form of predator in Namibia, which in Afrikaans, vermin are called ongedierte, which means not an animal. So if you think about that sort of on an ideological level, it's very interesting because animals like game, springbok, whatever, you hunt them according to these sort of imperial notions of manliness, of the thrill of the chase. With jackals, they're not animals, okay? They're not considered animals, ongedierte. They're de-animalized. So they're vermin, they eat your sheep. They're pests, they're to be dealt with as though they were insects and you kill them by whatever means necessary. So here we have an example of a post-jackal kill. This was taken out near Arawab in southeastern Namibia. And you'll see, you take actually quite a lot of pride in the fact that you got rid of these jackals from your farms, because it's part of the cost of production. If you don't kill jackals on your farm, you don't farm. It's a little hard to see because the screen is so shaky, but you'll see out, by this jackal's right paw, this big bulge coming out of it. I don't know if you can see it. They cut the stomach open of the jackal, which, again, this is starting a bit visceral and brutal, but you want to, every time you kill a jackal, you want to examine what's in its stomach. Otherwise, you want to know, what's it eating? Is it eating my sheep? Is it eating just hares and dassies? Is it eating other things? You want to understand the jackal. You want to know your enemy so that you can defeat it in the future. So that's sort of a very major character here. It's the main kind of vermin existing in Namibia. There are also what are called rooi cats, red cats, which are another kind of vermin that farmers face off with. They're a little bit less common, but nevertheless, they still predate on sheep, on lambs, on goats. These don't really deal with cattle very much because they can't take down cows. Then we have what are known as the problem animals. You don't call them predators because they don't eat your sheep, but they eat your grass. They're rock hyrax, they're dassies. They live in these little rocky crevices of these outcroppings on farms, and they're incredibly hard to kill because of how they live, how they don't burrow in the ground, so you can't poison them. You have to hunt them down one by one. Then we have the Cape and the scrub hare. They're very common in southeastern Namibia, and they eat the shit out of all the grasses. We're going to get more into them. Then you have the Cape gerbil, the nachtmeisje, which is, again, they eat the grass. If you do not have if you don't have some way of dealing with these populations, they begin to grow. Act one, the flora, the fauna, and the carnivore. So welcome to Namibia, the land of the brave. Namibia here is southwestern Africa. It borders Angola to the north, Botswana to the east, and South Africa to the south. For quite a long time, it was a South African colony, and South Africa governed it as its own. It put forth colonialism and apartheid, dividing the races, dividing the people, dividing the incomes. And to this day, even though Namibia has had independence since 1990, the effects of apartheid are still there. Throughout the 20th century, Namibia engaged in the anti-apartheid struggle in order to win its freedom. SWAPO, the Southwest Africa People's Organization, fought a war from exile, engaging in guerrilla struggle against this, the South African Defense Forces. This guerrilla war, they had the assistance of some other African nations, providing them with support, Zambia, Angola, other places. International partners supplied arms, medicine for refugees, etc., etc. And it took a lot of time, but this war eventually was successful. And by 1990, with the help of the United Nations, they were able to have elections. Nevertheless, though, the South Africans continued to go about trying to hold on to their colony. Kufuor here was one of the particularly nasty tactics. This was sort of a divide and rule strategy of taking some of the poorest Namibians and turning them to soldiers for these South African death squads, moving into certain farming areas and dividing families, dividing brother from sister, brother from brother. Now, Namibia is a pretty dry place, okay? It's got three different deserts residing within it. This is one, this is the Namib Desert, okay? You can actually see, though, that there's a farming fence. This is actually graded as farmland, though, which makes it a little bit strange that how could you farm in this, and this particular section is useless. Most farms in Namibia are huge because there are huge sections of them that you just can't farm in. Some of these farms will be up to 30,000 hectares. And for that reason, I mean, these are tremendous farms. For that reason, though, sometimes up to a third of a farm you just can't use for anything. Or you can only use it during years of particularly good rain. So, It's the south of the country, which is the area that we're going to be learning about tonight, is a particularly dry area. This again here is the Namib Desert. This is near Aus. This is now beginning to get more into farming territory. Okay, so this is sort of sheep farming areas, Karakul sheep farming areas. This is in the Bomboswart communal areas. Okay, so this is dry season, so it's a little bit drier than usual, but to be honest, down here, the dry season and the wet season is not a huge difference, and we'll learn a little bit about why. Again, Bomboswart's communal areas. You see these rocky outcroppings, these are prime dassie locations. Okay, so dassies, the rock hyrax, will hide within these. Every now and then come down and eat the grasses nearby. Sometimes come as far as a few miles away. Slowly though, during the wet season, the grasses get a little bit taller, a little bit more edible, to the stage where this, which is sort of near Arwa, the space where we saw that jackal killing, a bit more prime grassland is here. You can do very successful sheep farming, and even if you have good water resources and cattle as well. One of the main locations in southern Namibia here is the Orange River, which forms the border between Namibia and South Africa. South Africa to the left, Namibia to the right. A large part of the Orange River, though, is now used by multinational grape corporations for irrigated agriculture. And a lot of them have negotiated kind of sketchy deals with the Namibian government in order to access this. The amount of water getting pulled from the Orange River, which itself is a desert river, is affecting agriculture further down the river. So we're seeing a lot of problems today on these levels. I wish the screen wasn't so shaky. You're all probably getting quite dizzy, especially now. So, this is a rainfall map, which has what are known as isohaets. I forget how to pronounce the thing. Each of these lines represents a bit of rainfall. Okay, this line here is 50 millimeters of rainfall. 100 millimeters, 150. Now, I don't know if you know rainfall, but all of those are like no rainfall. Okay, we're talking about this entire section here gets less than most of the Gobi Desert. Okay, it gets less than Arizona. It gets less than nearly all parts of the world in which farming takes place. But nevertheless, these people are still able to successfully farm. And it's quite astounding, and that's why the Karakul sheep is so important, because as a desert breed of sheep, you can farm in these areas. Now, this represents a bit here, again, more rainfall, as well as the type of carrying capacity of each section. Carrying capacity is how much land you need per sheep. It's a very important statistic in certain farming areas, because you can plan how big my farm is versus how many livestock can I have before the farming gets overgrazed, before I start seeing degradation of the land. If you try to put too many sheep on your farm, you're going to have a lot of trouble. In Namibia, though, that statistic is a bit difficult, because this is known as what's a disequilibrium rangeland. We're getting now into ecological terms here. So this chart here is deviation from the average rainfall in Namibia. The average rainfall is the line going right down the center. Now, what you're looking for here, look for spots in which it's very close, within 50 millimeters from the norm. There are very few of them. It's going all over the place. It's very hard to predict how much rain you are going to get from one year to the next. So how are you supposed to calculate carrying capacity if every year your rainfall is going either drastically more than the norm or drastically less than the norm? Does that not make the norm somewhat of a useless subject? Maybe if I were a sheep farmer in New Zealand, where the rain is pretty regular, I can assume how much sheep I can have on my farm. In Namibia, it's a bit harder. So this is across the whole country. Let's take a look at a statistic a bit closer to southern Namibia. I'm not very good at Excel, don't judge me. So this is from 1951 to 1957, rainfall in 7 southern towns. You'll notice it's going up, down, left, right. The only one that's regular is Luderitz, which just gets no rain at all. So how are you supposed to calculate carrying capacity? It's very difficult. So a lot of farmers have to practice certain farming strategies by which during times of drought, once you see drought coming, you have to cull your stock quite significantly. Otherwise, you're going to see degradation. When the good times start coming, you quick, don't kill any. Let it go through. And with Karakul, this becomes a bit more easier, because by killing and culling your stock, you're getting a lot out of it, because you're getting these pelts. So it becomes excellent for a disequilibrium type of sheep. Now, under colonialism, as in a lot of other places, the black people in Namibia were pushed into a lot of these reserves, they called them. In the same way in the United States we have Native American reserves, which are some kind of shitty land removed from anything that's nice, and We give it just enough that you can survive. And that's sort of what went down here. A lot of these reserves here are particularly dry land. They're overcrowded, and to a large degree, they exist solely for the elderly, the women, and the children. The intention is that all able-bodied men will go work on white settler farms. That is the goal. They're only meant to keep those who cannot work alive. There's no goal for agricultural development in these areas. The goal is just to keep you alive and to segregate the labor force. These aren't supposedly tribal homelands. There's no ethnic origin to these. They're laid out by district, actually, by administrative district, so that each district can have a labor reserve. It was to solve the labor question, and if there's any sort of ethnic affinity, it's by accident. And these are basically the area we're talking about, south of the capital of Windhoek. All of those towns that you saw in this previous chart were on here. Now, we're going to move here to more ecology, because I love this. With vermin, onchedirte, problem animals, we're dealing with two kinds of competition between humans and wildlife. One is vertical predation. Violent conflict between predator and prey. Jackal eats lambs. Jackal eats dassies. Jackal eats rabbits. It's violent, and the solution is, according to these farmers, to kill the jackals. Horizontal competition is a little more complex in the sense that it's non-violent conflict over resources. The dassies eat the grazing. The hares eat the grazing, compete with sheep on those levels. And for those reasons, different farming systems have different fears of what you don't want. Horticulturalists, people who are going to farm crops, fruits, vegetables, actually like vertical predation. They don't mind jackals, actually, because jackals are going to eat the mice. Jackals are going to eat the rabbits, which are more likely to eat your crops. Meanwhile, if you are a pastoralist or a rancher, which means you're doing animal production by and large, which is what we see in southern Namibia, you fear vertical predation because these carnivores are going to seek out your sheep, are going to seek out your goats. So we're dealing with two kinds of predation. However, if you were to exercise too much culling of the predators, these farmers who do pastoral production will then face horizontal predation. If you kill too many jackals, those mice are going to go crazy. If you kill too many jackals, those rabbits are going to go crazy. So it's a balance that's very difficult to maintain in this ecology. Now, in southern Africa, there's always been conflict between predators and humans. Okay, this is not a new thing. Pastoralists have always fought with predators. No matter where you are in the world, it's occurred. If you're a Native American in America, you were going against wolves or coyotes. Here you're going against jackals and red cats. This has existed for quite a long time. However, over the past couple hundred years, this conflict has become more pronounced. It's become more pronounced partially because of colonialism. As these, what were called trekboers, in Afrikaans, a boer is a farmer. Okay, so a trekboer is a farmer that moves throughout the pasture, moves from one location to another without settling down. These pastoralists who kept sheep and cattle, they wanted to kill off the main predators, what were called apex predators. These were lions, these were hyenas. They were things that went after the cattle, the most valuable animal resource you had. And they did a pretty good job. I mean, of course, they're not extinct, but they don't really form a serious problem anymore unless you live near one of these game reserves that harbors lions. But what occurred is the decreasing in the numbers of lions and hyena led to what is known in ecological terms as mesopredator release. A mesopredator is a predator that's in between the prey and the apex predator. So sometimes scavengers are in this category. Jackals were in this category. Coyotes in America are in this category. As you eliminate the apex predator, these other things move up the food chain. Jackals no longer had a top dog, for lack of a better word. Now, jackals with a gestation period of about 60-something days with 4 to 5 pups per birthing were able to see their numbers rise like crazy throughout this area, moving their way especially to intensive sheep-farming districts of southern Africa. It began in South Africa, moved its way up to Namibia. And the diets changed. As a meso predator, often they were unable to get the springbok, they were unable to get the better prey. They were eating dassies, they were eating rodents, they were eating hares. But with now far more sheep and goats because of colonial imports, now they have a new prey. They have a new prey now. Act 2. Colonization, canines, and conflict. So here's a map of Namibia's relationship with South Africa. After the First World War, South Africa brought in its army fighting under the auspices of the Allies to come into the German colony of Deutsch Südwestafrika in order to bring it into the Union of South Africa as a fifth province. Under the United Nations, South Africa was given control over Namibia as a C-class mandate, which under the mandate system, there were A-class, B-class, and C-class. C-class were deemed the ones that were least ready for independence, and you didn't really have to do much preparation with these colonies, as opposed to, let's say, some of the ones in the Middle East, which were given A-class mandates. So we're seeing that South Africa didn't really care to prepare Namibia for independence in any sense of the word. It became a de facto colony of South Africa, itself a former colony. And if you see this dark red line, this was the railway. The only railway out of Namibia led to South Africa, cementing these ties between these two countries. In a way, though, South African colonialism looked pretty good compared to what the Germans were doing. These are some very graphic lynchings from the genocide of the Nama and the Herero, which were is classified as the first genocide of the 20th century. And throughout this genocide, it depopulated a lot of the countryside because of the sheer amount of people either killed or sent into exile. These are some Herero refugees coming back from Botswana, where they were sent into exile, or they were put to work on the building railroads as forced labor. Under German rule, especially after the genocide, most of these Germans suddenly needed labor. They had killed off most of the workers living in these areas. So they banned African cattle ownership in order to cripple the indigenous farm and turn these people into farm workers. And it became the South African invasion was actually welcomed in a sense because they knew what was coming under the Germans. And in the early days of South African rule, things actually did seem a bit more benign. Under the League of Nations system, there were a lot of competition between the South Africans and the Germans over who was going to control this colony. So the South Africans tried to portray themselves as people that were more interested in human rights, against corporal punishment. We're going to allow you to go back to your reserves and have cattle ownership. Things like that. It was very temporary, however. But nevertheless, it gave a lot of these African farmers, particularly the Nama in southern Namibia, the ability to reclaim some of their independence that they had before the German time. A lot of these German farmers were deported back to Germany. A lot of these farm workers stole, I use that in quotations because the land itself was stolen by the Germans. They stole farm supplies, they stole livestock, rebuilt their lives in a way in these reserves. Particularly good rains during these years helped them in order to reclaim a degree of independence. This may not have been prosperity, but it was taking themselves out of a relationship in which they were either forced to work or forced to work for a wage, and allowed them to practice a degree of somewhat successful subsistence farming. However, as this last little point shows, a lot of these farmers sought to recapture this peasantry in order to bring these people back under the control of the white farmers and the white colonial state, and to serve as cheap labor. The main dilemmas that these farmers had was two things. How do we farm in an ecologically difficult situation, and how do we get cheap labor? Within a region that was not terribly populated to begin with, and was depopulated by genocide, and always facing shortages of rain and shortages of pasture, these two questions reign supreme. However, these 5 years of supposed liberalism, tentative liberalism is the term, came the first major conflict of the South African period, which was the Bondelswarts Uprising. The Bondelswarts are a Nama nation in southern Namibia, just south of Karasburg, and they took arms against the South African administration in a very poorly organized guerrilla warfare, which failed relatively quickly. I'm not going to try to romanticize it. It didn't work, partially because these mountains that I told you were prime dassie locations earlier, this is Guruhas, which was bombed by the South African Air Force. It was the first ever use of the South African Air Force in putting down a so-called native uprising. And it worked very well. It killed countless livestock, several hundred fighters, as well as a large number of civilians. This is Abraham Morris, one of the guerrilla leaders, who both led the Bondelswarts in this uprising as well as in the previous World War I. Now, before and after the uprising, the Nama were complaining about a thing called the dog tax. Now, we've heard about taxation in colonial history, the hut tax, the head tax, poll taxes, all of these things existed all throughout colonialism, not just after colonialism. But this seemed really weird to me when I requested a file on housing and I got this file instead. Because I said, what on earth is it? Why would you tax dogs? That makes no sense to me. So basically, from 1917, a few years before this uprising, all dogs in urban and rural areas were subjected to a tax. Now, in urban areas, at this time, it was a pound. It gradually went up, and we'll see. And 5 shillings in rural areas. So 20 shillings to a pound. So that's between 2 to 4 weeks' wages in order to have your dog. I mean, that seems very steep. And if you failed to pay the tax, the police came and killed your dog. You still had to pay a fine, you sometimes faced jail time, and they came and they killed your dog. See here, these statistics were just from 1917 here. Destroyed African-owned dogs, 2,830. Destroyed European-owned dogs, 135. Now, at this time, the average European settler was only negligibly wealthier than the average African farmer. So this isn't that the Europeans were so fiscally responsible that they were able to pay the dog tax. This deals with who the dog tax was directed towards. And these statistics go on every single year with the dog tax, with roughly this ratio. Basically, there was an effort to remove African ownership of dogs. And so this seemed very, very, very strange to me. As I said, if you were caught not paying the tax, you had to pay a fine, sometimes face jail time, and the fine was often more than the dog tax itself. So you would sometimes lose your dog and then still have to pay the tax, and a higher tax, and now you have no dog. And the dog tax also was much more highly enforced in the southern district. And that's for a number of reasons. It was higher dog ownership, and as I'm about to show, a very important use of dogs. Now, why tax the dogs? A lot of these colonial administrators believed that the dog tax was a way to conserve game numbers. They believed that so-called native-owned dogs were hunting the game. They were running down all the game, killing our game numbers, now we have no game, yada, yada, yada. In fact, they passed a tax for £5 on what was on greyhounds, we know what they are, and a breed of dog known as a native hunting dog. What's a native hunting dog? Nobody knew what a native hunting dog was. There's folders upon folders of correspondence between police officers saying, I have a feeling I know what a native hunting dog is, I know that Europeans can't own native hunting dogs, but what's a native hunting dog? Can I tax this guy at £5? Now, £5 is a lot. £5 is 3 or 4 months of wages to have access to the dog. That seems, I mean, it's outrageous. So of course people were not paying for the dog tax. A lot of times what they would do is when they would hear that the police were coming into town to check if you paid your tax, people will just take the dog and then they're subject to an additional fine. When you actually go through the files on the destruction of game in the archives, on the conservation department on destruction of game, nobody ever blames it on the dog tax. Only when they're talking about dog tax do they mention that dogs hunt game. When they're talking about hunting game, they say, oh, it's these guys from South Africa, they come in their motor cars with all these guns and they kill everything. Nobody ever mentions dogs when they're actually dealing with game. They only mention game when they're dealing with dogs, which is really strange, the way that these guys are thinking, because in the end, these guys weren't using the dogs to hunt game. No matter how much this guy, the administrator of Southwest Africa, was saying that they did. And this quote, I put it up in full because it's very revealing. It says, the necessity of this heavy tax was clearly demonstrated during my southern tour in early 1921 when I found a vast number of dogs in possession of natives and a certain class of European squatters who profited by the employment of these animals to hunt down game and obtained a livelihood thereby instead of by honest labor. And I think that last term, honest labor, is very key because irregardless of if you're hunting game or not, you're doing something that isn't honest. If you're not taking up work on farms, it's somehow now dishonest labor. Honest labor is conceived of as wage labor. So in a way, by looking at the dog tax this way, the Bundelswartz uprising is now becoming much more clear. Because the dog tax is sometimes about making people take up wage labor, addressing these labor concerns for white farmers. Now, of course, when you talk to the Bundelswartz today, they say, no, we don't hunt game, partially because in Barenbad it's way too dry, there is no game. And they say, we had dogs because we wanted to protect our sheep from jackals. That is why we kept dogs. We kept dogs because when we go out with our sheep, we bring one or two dogs with us at all times to help us guide the sheep as a sheepdog would. But also, if a jackal comes, the jackal will be fended off or killed by the dogs. There's a complex process the Nama in southern Namibia would use to train dogs, to get them ready in order to go out into the veld with their sheep. For example, this interview I conducted with Joseph Roy, in which he mentioned, you go out with two dogs just in case the jackal's a female. Or this very old agricultural study in which you take raw meat in order to familiarize the dog with you, the owner, and with your sheep. Very elaborate strategies that people would use in order to ready your dogs to protect sheep. So now we begin to see also that the dog tax is about agriculture. If you don't have dogs to protect your sheep, predation rates from jackals and other predators is going to increase. So the dog tax is not just, let's get you to work on white farms, but let's also, in order to pay for that tax, but let's also cripple your ability to be successful farmers. It's sort of a double subsidy for white farmers. It's a very unusual circumstance. Now, beyond just protecting dogs, the dogs protecting the sheep from jackals, dogs were useful in other ways, such as this interview I conducted in which he's saying, during the war, these colonizers, they were poisoning the water holes. They were poisoning our wells. So anytime we would go to a source of water during the war, we'd always make our dogs go first. We'd always make the dogs drink the water first. If they're not going to drink or if they're not going to wash, you stay away from that water. So it's sort of this also, it's not a man's best friend idea of dogs. It's a very materialist concern that these dogs are part of who we are. Now, the Bundelswartz were also reacting to a series of laws that were passed throughout the 1920s, which were facilitating the settlement of whites from South Africa into Namibia. In order to both offset the economic power of the German settlers, as well as just increase the numbers of white people in the territory, the colonial state was subsidizing land, subsidizing farming supplies, subsidizing the movement of people from South Africa to Namibia. Now, if you, I don't know if you've ever heard, but in the 1930s, there was a commission called the Carnegie Commission, which was about poor whiteism in South Africa, which was meant to say, what are the struggles that poor white people are facing? This was a preemptive way of dealing with that. Oh, you don't have land in South Africa, let's just send you to Namibia. So that began to occur. Now, I'm going to show you a series of maps here, which unfortunately are a bit poor scans, so it's hard to see. But this is going to show you differences in settlement over time. I want you to focus on the color brown here, which of course, because it's shaking like crazy, you can't see. But this is towards the end of the German colonial period in the south. Actually, it's very sparsely settled. There aren't a lot of farmers occupying lands. So what this meant is this area was called crown land. Crown land meant it was owned by the state. If you wished to graze your livestock on that land, you would have to take out a grazing license from the government for a small fee, and you can utilize that land. A lot of people liked having crown land near them because if there's drought and if your land is too overcrowded, you can move your sheep to the next farm. You can move your sheep nearby and have emergency grazing. Now, 10 years later, at the beginning, about a year into the land settlement program, you see the settlements, it's not getting much denser. They're really bringing quite a lot of farmers, reducing the amount of land near this here, the Bundelswarts Reserve. So what you're seeing is these farmers, these Bundelswarts farmers, are getting more and more hemmed in at all sides by white colonial farmers. Now look, about 15 years later, it's nearly fully settled at this stage. This is the Namib Desert. You can't farm over there. So it's now nearly fully settled down here. This map here just happened to be on the same page, so I apologize for that. But this is what happened once apartheid comes, where they say, we don't want any black people down here. Let's move you all to actually worse land up here, at Namibland. So this was sort of the idea of apartheid, is we're going to give you separate countries. We're going to declare these to be separate countries. And then you can not actually be citizens of Namibia anymore. You're a citizen of Namibland, but you still have to come work for us. So in addition to just making it more difficult to get access to crown land, the increased settlement of white farmers had an effect on vermin, an effect on jackals. Part of the subsidies, not just providing you with land, but you could also take out loans in order to increase your livestock, increase your breeding stock. So the Platfontein farm at Maltahoe, which is one of the districts in the southwest, was founded in 1923 through the land settlement program with 13 sheep. Now 13 sheep could fit like right over there and they'd eat the carpet and they'd actually be content. But then within the next year, he got it up to 400. And this wasn't just this farmer, this was dozens and dozens and dozens of farmers, drastically increasing the amount of sheep in this country. And now it's nicely corralled within wire fencing, which jackals can enter and sheep can't leave. It's prime feast season now for the jackal. And you see throughout these early years of land settlement that the number of jackals is increasing like crazy, partially because of all of these things, the mesopredator release, getting rid of lions, and the movement now of lots of new sheep onto the pastures. Act 3. Poison, predation, and prey. Now a lot of white farmers didn't like the fact that technically they had to pay the dog tax too. So they found ways around this. They formed what were known as jackal clubs. Jackal clubs were only for European farmers in order to take a number of different farmers. Your dogs, if you affiliated them with this club, would now be tax-free so long as you met, I think, once a month in order to hunt vermin, which is honestly what you're going to do anyway. But now it's tax-free. But of course, you had to only be a European male in order to do this. You had to be a resident of a farm in order to do this. So, in a sense, black Namibians now were paying the dog tax in order to protect their sheep from jackals, while white farmers were getting it tax-free in order to do the very same thing. So it's quite interesting that in addition to just providing the subsidized taxation, these farmers were getting subsidized strychnine poisoning, one of the key ways to get rid of jackals is you slaughter one sheep, you lace it with strychnine, you throw it into the field, jackals will come overnight, and they'll all be dead by morning. Or eventually, gallium poison, compound 1080 poison, which is hypersensitive to cannabis, as well as what are called hipskeeters, so poison guns. It's actually an American creation called the coyote getter, which is, we'll get to that actually. Now, one of the other key things with the jackal clubs is the goal. Jackals don't know farm boundaries. A jackal will go to a different farm if he thinks that he can eat something there. The jackal clubs allow you free access to any farm neighboring your registered club. So the goal was to remove jackals, not necessarily to provide property rights. But what would happen if you were on the border of one of these so-called African reserves? You are allowed free entry into this reserve. You are able to trespass into this area in order to kill jackals. And if you managed to find any jackals in this area, you could fine the people in this African reserve up to £20 for the service of removing this jackal. Now, £20 at this time was a lot of money. You would find what was called the captain, who was the head of the so-called tribal trust fund. Now, they could then take the jackal proof, go to the magistrate and say, I killed a jackal, here, give me a reward. And he would then get a reward, not just for hunting the jackal from the reserve, but he would also get it from the magistrate. So being a jackal hunter became a very profitable enterprise. Here's another example of a jackal hunt club near the Bondelswarts Reserve. So these guys were able to enter the reserve to get any jackals, supposedly, which strayed from these farms into there. But there's no way of proving this. And under colonialism, who generally gets believed? There were other issues, though, regarding jackals that weren't just about the jackals coming and eating your sheep. Jackals necessitated a process called corralling, which in America we call corralling. But it's a process of at night, you want to take your sheep and protect them. So you'll build oftentimes stone enclosures, mud enclosures, move in with your sheep at night, close the gate in such a way that jackals cannot access your sheep at night. And what happens though with that is diseases between the sheep, such as scab mites, transfer much more easily if you're in a enclosed space. Furthermore, manure and things like that, which are very useful for fertilizing the pastures, are now concentrated at one spot. So you're seeing degradation of the pastures and transfer of diseases between the sheep. But if you could find a way to control predation, you don't have to do this anymore. Because the only reason to do this is really to avoid predation. A lot of things, though, began to change, though. You know how I mentioned Karakul sheep? They really exploded in the 1930s. The 1930s brought a huge drought to Namibia. This bottom graph, which may be hard to see with the shaky screen, is raw livestock numbers. Now look at 1933 here. The numbers of sheep plummet. The numbers of everything plummet, really. Goats, horses, whatever. The numbers plummet, and then the next year they immediately start rising up. It was basically two years in which there was absolutely no rain. But now look at the top graph. This designates the kind of sheep as it's rebuilding. The kind of sheep. Look what happens with blue, Karakul sheep, as opposed to Afrikaner sheep, which are Cape Fattail and Merino sheep. Karakul sheep, over the couple of years after that drought, really, really, really break through, because people realize, at the end of this drought, the only sheep that were left were Karakul. Karakul are the best desert sheep. So let's all invest in this sheep. So what occurs, though, is over time, the state begins to subsidize Karakul production. They realize this is the future of agriculture in this arid region. It's a hardy desert breed, you slaughtered the lamb pelts, I already went into that. In addition, it's non-perishable. Let's say there's bad market conditions one year. If you properly prepare the pelts, you can just keep them for the next year until the prices of pelts go back up. Those pelts, as long as you prepare them correctly, unlike, let's say, mutton, which is going to go bad really quickly, you have a lot more flexibility as a Karakul farmer. This, by the way, is just an example of what eventually gets made with pelts. I don't know how many sheep go into making a coat like this, but it must be quite a lot, because these are little sheep. Furthermore, there was a lot of infant industry protection for the caracal industry. There was no exporting of caracal rams outside of Southwest Africa / Namibia. You couldn't even send them to South Africa for many years. The Angolans tried to create an industry that wouldn't allow it. In fact, you had a lot of guys, there was a big business smuggling rams in and out of the country. Furthermore, a lot of farmers did not like the fact that black Namibians wanted to participate in this very wealthy, very profitable industry, because they felt, we have a reputation here as a producer of this type of fur. We don't want to give that up. We don't want these people to diminish the quality of it, which frankly was ridiculous. But the state bought into it, and it made it, they were very reluctant. Although it was illegal to restrict black people from buying these rams, they could say, we're just not going to subsidize it. So yeah, this coat is made from this little fellow. And you can see here, the caracal sheep begin to rise like crazy. Now, with the increased profits from caracal production, farmers were able to create probably the most crucial thing that occurred in the history of this region, which was the vermin-proof fence. It's a very expensive kind of fence because it requires a lot of wire. You have to build an ordinary fence with just standard galvanized wire, which is meant to keep in sheep, but not necessarily keep out predators, and add on a significant amount of mesh wire. You bury it under the ground up to 6 inches, and oftentimes you build a veranda on top, because you don't want jackals digging under it, nor do you want them climbing over it. These, from 1951, became subsidized immensely by the government, of the colonial government. Here's some other ways in which people did it. This was a much more expensive way, in which it was just many, many, many barbed wires. In addition, the state subsidized the importation from Colorado of the humane coyote getter. This strategy, basically what you do is you take one of these tubes, you put it into the ground, you hammer it into there, it's got a spring-loaded or sometimes gunpowder-loaded propulsion unit, as well as a little bit of bait on the top. The dog goes, any type of dog, coyotes, jackals, what have you, or sometimes just ordinary domestic dogs, will bite down on the bait. The removal of the bait causes the spring of the gunpowder to shoot a cyanide pellet up into the animal, killing it very quickly. They littered the countryside by the 1970s. People wanted to kill jackals at any means, and they would import lots of these. Every couple weeks, you go around, see which ones got set off, replace the bait, replace the cyanide. And these were subsidized by the Namibian, or at that time, Southwest African government. We should understand, though, that like fencing and these strategies, well, not the coyote getter, but fencing doesn't actually kill jackals, except what you kill within the enclosure. It fences out jackals, and it makes it easier for you to kill them in size. The fence itself doesn't kill anything. It just fences them out. It makes it harder for them to move into the enclosure. And the fenced out jackals are just going to go where there isn't fencing, which in this case is often the African reserves. So what we're seeing then is increasing the predation rate on less capitalized farms, which actually is crippling black agriculture further, creating more wage laborers to solve this labor issue. And then sort of this is one of the most crucial points of fencing. Fencing ruined farm labor. You now, if you have a properly fenced farm, a jackal-proofed farm, you can cut down the number of shepherds you have by up to 77%, is the highest statistic I've seen. At least 50% of your laborers on your farm can be made redundant by fencing your farm. Because what occurs now is you can take 5-6 shepherds whose main job was to guide the sheep, keep away the jackals, move them to water, and replace them with one camp walker. A camp walker doesn't tend to sheep, he tends to fences. He just makes sure that fencing is intact, that it's keeping out the jackals properly. And what you see then is far fewer farm laborers existing on these farms. These guys now are becoming more rare. The farms are decreasing sometimes to just 3 farm laborers. So this, the fencing and all of these strategies crippled black agriculture, created a labor pool of unemployed people in the reserves whose eventually their only strategy was let's get farm labor. Now they are kicked out of that in a way. Furthermore, a lot of these guys by now were bringing in workers from the north through migrant labor. This was northern Namibia is more highly populated, and it was a very expensive process to bring in workers from the north in these 1 or 2 year contracts. But eventually, with more profits through the karakul industry, they could do that. So local labor is now just completely unemployed. Act 4. Dassie plague, vermin ecology, and the failure of karakul. Act 4 is short, don't worry. Now, 1966, Arawab is a town in southeastern Namibia, faces an incredible plague of hares, coming completely wiping out most of the pasture in the area. Arawab was one of these areas that had the highest rate of jackal eradication. Jackals were pretty much gone in Arawab by the 1960s. And people began to realize, a lot of conservation organizations said, in the past year, you killed 22,000 jackals in Arawab. Maybe you shouldn't have done that. Because now we're losing all of the grass that our sheep need to eat. You're getting rid of the thing that eats our sheep, and now our sheep have nothing to eat, and it's dying anyway. The same thing began to occur in the Karas Mountains. Okay, in the Karas Mountains, where you have a lot of these rocky outcroppings, dassies, who now have no jackals to predate against them, also eagles are eagles in Namibia eat dassies as well, and those were getting killed through these subsidies as well, not just jackals, are now coming out and eating the pastures. The same thing is occurring in Oriental with gerbils. So basically the Department of Nature Conservation brings in a lot of ecologists to try to solve this problem, and they're trying to say, look, we're facing an issue. Do we continue killing all these jackals or do we not? And a lot of these guys now were trained in the discipline of ecology. They were not farmers by trade, they were ecologists by trade. And they understood a bit of these inner workings of predator ecology, that you can't completely wipe out predators. We've seen what happens in the United States when we do that, and now we're seeing it here in Namibia. But they were coming up, they were butting heads with the Karakul Breeders Association, one of the largest taxpayers in the entire country, which was funding these eradication campaigns. So you're seeing a bit of a conflict here between the business interests of farming and the ecology of farming. And a lot of them were avid readers of the American ecologist Aldo Leopold. And Aldo Leopold wrote this book called The Sand County Almanac, which had a very famous passage, Thinking Like a Mountain, which is that if you're just going to look at the bottom line, you're going to miss the whole point, which is that in the way that you get rid of all the wolves on the mountain so that the deer can grow, the deer populations may ruin the mountain itself. It ended up kind of all being for naught, though, because in the 1980s, probably the worst drought in Namibian history occurs. The early 80s plummet the Karakul sheep market. Not only the fact that furs just weren't in fashion anymore, but also the fact that they had no grass to eat in the first place. People began switching to other things like game farming, which requires even less labor. It requires a more intensive fence system to keep in these game for tourism purposes. But a lot of people anticipated the independence of Namibia. They anticipated it and said, let me get out of this karakul industry and join in something new. But the effect it had on labor was somewhat the same, which was decreasing labor, increasing unemployment, decreasing wages. Game farming requires virtually no labor. Oh, you want an encore? What does this story tell us about capitalism and the environment? And this is sort of our final little lesson here. What's the difference between a scythe, what you cut grain with, and a John Deere combine harvester, that big-ass green thing? It's not just that they're different technologies. It's that what they represent are completely different social formations surrounding agriculture. A scythe is much more about subsistence agriculture, the sort of, for lack of a better word, small-time agriculture. In the same way that a scythe is very different from a John Deere harvester, which implies a huge level of urbanization, implies lots of other things, dogs as a way to control jackals, and then fences, strychnine, coyote getters, all of these things, don't just represent different technologies of killing jackals. They represent a whole different purpose. Because creating a form of capitalism based on sheep production requires dealing with these dilemmas. And in a way, the Nama have always struggled against jackals, but colonialism and capitalism changed it. They exacerbated these problems in a number of different ways by increasing the number of jackals, decreasing the number of jackals, increasing the number of dassies, decreasing the number of dassies. And I sort of gave this talk the title, Caught Between a Rock and a High Rise, because we sort of get, it doesn't solve any of these problems. It just moves them around. And finally, creating a plot of wage laborers is not natural. There's nothing natural about being a wage worker, about somebody that sells his ability to work for cash money. That's something that has to be created. And when I describe the process of these guys removing themselves from wage labor, going into the reserves, practicing subsistence agriculture, moving themselves away from white capitalist farming, the state had to take measures to pull them back. And those measures were not free market measures. Those were coercive. Those were deliberate. And we have to remember this when we're studying economics, when we're studying these things, that these things are not natural. These are historical creation, what Marx termed primitive accumulation, the process of divorcing the producer from the means of production. And that's a process, and we have to really take that seriously when studying these things. So, I thank you all. I actually talked longer than I thought. I went to the amount that you asked me to talk for. Okay,
thank you very much
for listening.
Wow, that was so good. I feel like we probably need more than one lecture on this topic, because it was just so interesting. Yeah. I feel like a lot of people read the title and weren't quite sure about what this was going to be about and probably didn't come. But it's cool because I got it recorded, so they will regret it. And they will hear me say that on the video. Because there's not that many of us, I think we don't really need much moderation for the question and answer. So if you guys have any questions, just put your hand up and just ask Bernard. Anyone? I've actually got a question myself, so maybe I can kick it off. Because you said something, you talked about like competition at one point in the beginning between it was humans and jackals, I think.
Yeah.
And I was a bit confused because I thought jackals were quite small animals.
Well, jackals aren't going to eat humans. I mean, very few humans die from jackals. I mean, every now and then it does happen. But that's not really what the human wildlife conflict is, the survival of society. It's more societal. So jackals don't even kill cows very often. I mean, every now and then it does happen. Sometimes there's a pack. But one jackal can't kill a cow, really. It's sheep and goats that jackals can get. So when I brought up this issue of predation, vertical versus horizontal predation somewhere. Come on. There we go. Vertical predation is a form of conflict against wildlife that is violent. That is, you have this form of wildlife that literally just wants to eat this form of wildlife. This jackal wants to eat this sheep, as opposed to horizontal, which is a conflict over resources, conflict over grasses, conflict over things like that. So, like a hare doesn't want to eat your sheep, but a jackal does. That's sort of the distinction that I tried to make. And that, yeah. You know, I gave a similar lecture in one of my classes, and one of the graduate students said, well, it's very unusual to see the fear and the hatred for carnivores, because in my society, we actually like them quite a lot. And I said, well, because is it a crop-growing society? Do you grow fruit? Do you grow vegetables? You know, is that the form of agriculture you practice? And she said, yes. And I said, because there's these different fears. You guys don't like these ground animals. If I'm a pastoralist, I don't like jackals. So I hope, does that sort of address?
Yeah. That makes sense, yeah.
Yes, Jay.
Question. What's the state now in Namibia with all this? What is it? what, you know, what has the country learned? How did it move forward? You know, any reconciliation? What?
Okay. So I'll mention that quick. So there's no longer widespread state subsidies for jackal elimination. Jackals are still an issue, but there is no longer this very racialized process of doing this anymore. So that doesn't really mean health, because these subsidies were very crucial to making, also just making them feel relevant within society. But you still today have very large issues with land. There are actually, it's a very contested issue right now. They've just fired the deputy minister of lands because he actually tried to push a more radical policy of land distribution from whites to blacks, or from the powerful to powerless, and they fired him over that. Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about, I'm just kind of confused as to where that, like, the wage laborers are coming from. Are they, and then you said, like, there's also sort of like the black owned farms that are sort of the wage laborers going to, like, the white owned farms, or the, like, how exactly is the, okay, are the dynamics between them?
Sure. So in this, this map is 1956, which is sort of the heart of this study. If you see these little checkered areas, not checkered, lines, these are areas which are black owned and black controlled. So it doesn't matter which ethnicity you are, it's just deemed as native area, native locations and reserves in Southwest Africa. So, for example, you have the Barisabo Reserve, Tess Reserve, Bundleswartz Reserve. All of these areas were, the, for lack of a better word, the homelands of these black workers. That if you couldn't find employment on a white farm, you would go work, you would go back to your home area. And you were always a visitor. Even if you were working sometimes for grazing access, sometimes you'd be a wage laborer doing farm work 3 days a week, and you could move your family and your livestock to a corner of this guy's farm and do your own farming. If he wanted to kick you off, he could kick you off. And so that's sort of where these guys are coming from. And as fewer workers were needed on these white-owned farms, more people got sent back to these reserves, making them more overcrowded, more overgrazing, more things like this. Yes, Julio.
Thank you. It's really very illustrative, and it's better organized, I have to say. No, it's very comprehensive, very good. I have two things. What happened with this? Are you going to include some demographic studies on this research? Like, how this demographic pressure acts on that population? Because, you know, you get no farming, you get or crippled farming in these areas, and then demographic pressure. Yeah. Another one, the wires. I'm interested in that. In where do they come from? Who did they buy it from? Who gets benefited from these systems?
Sure. So on the first question of demographic pressures, in the final dissertation, I have to have a part on this, because some of this leads to urbanization as well. Some of these guys who are not finding successful farming in the reserves, they can't find wage labor outside, they can't really farm successfully. A lot of these people are moving to towns. And I don't have very good statistics on this, and I think it is a way that I need to develop it, so thank you for that. With regards to the wire, most of that is coming from South Africa. South Africa is producing it. There's like they have steelworks that are producing it. They have machines that are weaving it. Because it's a very late, if you tried to weave a jackal proof fence by hand, that would take quite a long time. So they actually have these machines, I used to know the name of it, that would actually weave the products. But with the importation, the key with that was to join a farming association, which again was a whites-only endeavor. But you can import it in bulk for all of the members of your regional farming association, and you save cost on these, not to mention the fact that it's subsidized by the state, but it's not 100% subsidized. So, but in a way, sometimes these fences also act in this sort of visual way of demarcating private land ownership as well, which is sort of like the way that the countryside then gets viewed.
Great. Here's one question, please. You've done a lot of research on this. I mean, how much time do you spend in South Africa, you know, or in Namibia? You know, that's a lot of work you've done. Can you expand on the methodology a little bit?
Sure. So most of this is based on archival research at the National Archives of Namibia. Very little research have I done in South Africa. Although there are similar processes going on, it's a whole different ship. So most of it is based on, I've done 8 months now, about 8 months of work at the National Archives of Namibia, gathering documentation on this, and preliminary oral history work. That's something that I'm trying to develop now, is trying to go and speak with a lot more farmers about their lived memories, rather than just trying to build this through statistics. Because you can also get two very different perspectives on that, the one that comes through the stats and the one that comes through the memory. And it doesn't necessarily make one more right than the other, but it's good to have those two in dialogue. And at the moment, this is much more coming through the statistics, the ecology, the science parts. It needs to be fleshed out.
Very good.
Is that it? Well, thank you very much then.